May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be always pleasing in your sight. O Lord, our strength and our redeemer. Amen. Amen. Take a seat. So today we're remembering Irenaeus of Lyon. I think Lyons. I don't speak French. Lyons? Lyon? 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 Sounds very posh. I was going to say he's one of my favorite church fathers, but there's so many.
It's like I like them all. They're cool.
He was born around the year 130, and he was a priest in Lyon. And the Christians there were being persecuted, so he was sent off sort of as an ambassador to plead for some interceding. On a political scale. Anyway, while he was gone, all the priests were killed. So he came back and found himself as basically the last man standing and became the bishop of Lyon. And where he worked primarily in a pastoral capacity. However, he's remembered for his writing. And he wrote a work which translates as roughly Against Heresies. And the one that perhaps garnered the most attention, and still does, is this heresy called Gnosticism. You know how we spell knowledge with a K in the front? It actually comes from the same place. So G-N-O-S-T-I-C-I-S-M, Gnosticism. And it's still a really significant problem in the churches. You'd think that, you know, we would have moved on from that, but there's nothing new under the sun, really, in regards to that. I thought today what I might do is try and sell you on Gnosticism so that you can see the appeal. Because I figure, you know, it's really easy to go, oh, well, we're not like that. But unless you can see why it might have been appealing to people, you won't necessarily see perhaps where it's taken root in ourselves. So the first thing about Gnosticism, it comes from this word knowledge. And it's this idea that there is secret knowledge that helps you understand and guarantees access into heaven. Now, it's not necessarily open to everyone. For most of the Gnostics, you sort of had to be born into the right group in order to be able to even learn this secret knowledge. And if that sounds like most of the modern conspiracy movies out there, there's a reason for that. There's this deep desire that people have to think that someone out there is in charge. And if you just know how to ask the right questions, if you know the right handshake, if you know, then what you will have is you'll have the access and the insight to cut through all the fog that makes living so complicated and difficult. You know, it's this desire for there to be secret knowledge which makes sense of the world, because everybody wants to make sense of the world, and it is hard and it's complicated, and we want it to be easy. And even if we don't have the secret knowledge, as long as someone has the secret knowledge, then it's at least in theory makes sense, even if it's just to someone on the outside. Desire for the world to make sense. It's one of the big drives in Gnosticism. And we look at the world and we see that there's pain and there is suffering, and we're really fortunate in our current circumstance, because most of the pain and suffering we experience is pretty limited compared to what Irenaeus would have been dealing with on a daily basis. You know, this time in history they were, you know, slaves. Women had no rights, there were children starving in the streets. Christians were still being unusual, because we were rescuing children who had just been left to die. It was a tough time. It was a dark time for much of the world. And so what there was this problem that people had, this intellectual difficulty they had between this language of a God who is perfect, who is the creator, and their daily experience of a world that had pain and suffering in it. And so the next thing about Gnosticism is there was this picture they had of the way the universe operated. They didn't have the picture the world is round, but it was more like an onion, if you will. So many, many, many layers, archons and all sorts of cool sounding names. And at the very top was God, who is perfect. And then underneath that were various different layers of gods and spirits and creative powers and all the way down to Earth. And then even below Earth, perhaps, there would have been even darker and more horrible realms. The drive, though, there, this is a really interesting thing, was to protect God. See, God is perfect, and we cannot have a God who is sullied, either by the dirt of this world, or perhaps by even being associated with the dirt of this world in terms of having created this world. Is this not the question we often get? If God is all-powerful, all-loving, kind, why is there pain? And one of the answers that they had was they removed God from the equation, or they moved God as far away as they could, at least. You can see how Gnosticism would be deeply attractive to many people. There are some problems with it, and we should know those, because those are also life-affirming problems. The first is this idea that there is secret knowledge. There is no secret knowledge in Christianity. I mean, there's some fairly odd and obscure bits of historical information, but they're not a secret. You know, there is no secret writing of Jesus that only the few elect have. Jesus, in all likelihood, couldn't write. Most people couldn't back then, couldn't. There is no secret knowledge. Which means, unfortunately, that you've got to battle through the complexities of the world on a daily basis. But it also means that we all have access to all of it. Everything we have is open to all. Profoundly important. And the other thing, the difficulty of the world. Why is that such a problem? Once again, it's a problem because of Jesus. Jesus is often a thorn in the side of these beautiful ideas. Because Jesus is God with us, and the greatest act of love that God shows to us is being one of us in the dirtiest, muckiest, most painful of environments, up to and including being crucified. Now that is really important, because one, it says that although the world has its pains, it's not so bad that God has given up on creation. But it's also important because it says that there is stuff here that is worth working with, that is able to be redeemed. And if we are God's agents, then we should be affirming the goodness of creation and working to redeem it. So I can understand the appeal of Gnosticism, but I'm deeply grateful to Irenaeus because a large portion of what he did is argue against it, and to protect us from these ideas of an easily understandable world and a world that is dark and irredeemable. Rather, we have a world that is complicated, but that God loves and values, and that we should be working to make better. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, Amen.